Hello, everybody, and welcome to the WWE RAW review for March 28th, 2016, the go-home show leading to WrestleMania 32, the showcase of the Immortals, the biggest event of the year for WWE and for professional wrestling as a whole. Thank you for joining me here today. I am your host, EM Ultra Uprising, with the review of Raw and the final build to WrestleMania, my thoughts on everything. I will be back with you guys later on in the week with a live video featuring the winner of my Royal Rumble contest, Jasmine Robinson, and we're going to be going down the card and predicting WrestleMania 32. That is scheduled for Thursday. So that will be a Thursday afternoon. I'll post an official time on Twitter during the week, which you can follow me at in the link in the description, at EM Ultra Official. Let's get into Raw. And also, I'm all set with Q&A questions. That video is probably going to come somewhere in the mix of this week, or maybe it might be post-WrestleMania a day or two after. I'm not 100% sure. Just a really just crazy time during my college semester, so bear with me. Let's review Raw. Shane McMahon and Undertaker. My God, was this a great segment. So they kick off the night, and we get a promo, we get a brawl, we get great buildup, is what we get. Now, this is a feud, a match that has a lot of implications. If Shane wins, he gets power. If Undertaker loses, he's out. You know, and if Shane loses, then he doesn't get power. And Undertaker, you know, gets a win. He basically is playing the role of almost like a hitman for Vince McMahon. He doesn't really like Vince McMahon. He's not really his right-hand man. He's just doing what he's doing because this is what he loves. And that he just is going to destroy anybody in his path. Doesn't matter who it is. Doesn't matter what it's for. So Undertaker just doesn't give a fuck. He just wants to beat some ass. And this, honestly, was the best way to build this feud up. Because we had a promo segment a couple weeks ago that was honestly terrible. And honestly, it was kind of a mediocre build along the way. There were some great video packages. And Shane's return segment was awesome. But honestly, I didn't really get a whole lot between Shane and Undertaker. That is until tonight. The elbow drop through the table from Shane off the top rope. Unbelievable moment. And the crowd was marking out. And they should be. This was an unbelievable way to show. Like, this sold anybody who wasn't on this match. This should sell you. Like, that's what the Go Home Show should do, is prove to you why these matches are good, why they matter, why they're important, why this is exactly where WrestleMania needs to be, and they brought it home with Shane and Undertaker. This is the match I've been honestly looking forward to the most, and they reaffirmed that notion here on this episode of Raw with an excellent opening segment. Not only that, but with Shane McMahon also taking a huge shot at Undertaker, saying that his legacy died 2 years ago when he lost his streak. And Undertaker coming back and saying that Shane has been Vince's bitch since the day he was born. I mean, they made it personal, they fought, they did everything they needed to do. Perfect way to kick off Raw. That doesn't mean that everything necessarily which followed would continue to be along this path. Now, the first match of the night was our next segment. And so, yeah, obviously, I had two thumbs up for that first one. Zack Ryder defeating Chris Jericho, though, in our first match with AJ Styles, actually, causing a distraction at ringside. I think that the build-up for AJ Styles and Chris Jericho has been kind of standard. It really hasn't done anything to innovate or do anything crazy. And I think the same could be said for quite a few of these matches come WrestleMania. I am looking forward to Chris Jericho versus AJ Styles in terms of the fact that I know these two guys will put on an enjoyable contest. But I'm really kind of disappointed at the same time, because I think there could have been more innovation along the way. You know, like, for example, when they were running backstage a couple of weeks ago, or even last week, you know, we didn't get any type of follow-up with it. Not anything that really felt all that crazy personal. You know, they formed the tag team, and then they broke it up, and that's the most excitement I felt from this feud at all. And honestly, it felt like they had already reached its blow-off when Styles won the rubber match back at, what was it, Fastlane? I mean, to be completely honest, I didn't think this feud needed to continue beyond Fastlane. I've been saying that all along. Although this will be a good match again, I think this feud really didn't need to continue onward. Zack Ryder got a win. That's nice for him. But the simple distraction finish, I don't know. Eh. Nothing all that special. And I think really Zack Ryder benefits from the win mainly just because he's in the Intercontinental title ladder match. And trust me, we'll get to that whole scenario a little bit later on. So this segment for me is like a thumbs middle. It wasn't terrible, but it definitely wasn't great. Second match of the night was Charlotte defeating Becky Lynch with Sasha Banks at ringside. And, Ric Flair ended up grabbing at Becky's leg, and then Charlotte was able to hit her with a natural selection. I don't even know if she hit her with natural selection. I can't even remember the finish. It might have just even been a straight kick. Either way, Charlotte wins the match, and Sasha kind of just was there, and that was all they did. They really didn't go any further. And this is a great example of a feud which I said in the past, honestly, was better built than some of the other ones. Now, that's not saying a whole lot when some of these feuds have had some pretty piss-poor build. This one definitely struggled compared to what it could have been, compared to what we did get in NXT. I mean, these are three of the four horsewomen. This is a piece to the puzzle that could be so huge. This could be a revolution for women's wrestling, like they're supposed to be, you know, trying to do here. But instead, it feels like it's just another regular Divas title feud. I will say it does feel like there's some seriousness. It does feel like all three of these women actually are going after the title, and there's no other stupid BS going on with it. And finally, we're getting a match at WrestleMania that's for the title that isn't a bunch of people. Now, obviously, there's going to be another women's match that is a bunch of people. We'll get to that later as well. But I do like the mood, the temperature of this feud and the way it's been built. But I think that they have missed a huge opportunity to make this, the history of them in NXT, how much history they have to get working together, working against each other, etc. And they have dropped the ball with that. So anyway, this segment, again, like a thumbs middle, whatever. Didn't do anything to really, you know, push or pull me in any direction. So we got a nice little backstage segment with Vince McMahon and Shane McMahon, where Shane, the memorable quote from this is that Shane says, "You stole this company from your dad, now I'm taking it from you." That was a great quote from Shane, and not only that, but it was another nice piece of build-up for Shane and Undertaker. The personal rivalry between father and son, the rivalry between Shane and Undertaker, all of that built up, thrown in there, and done nicely. And I remember tweeting out that they did more to build this feud up effectively in 45 minutes than they had over the last month. So this is a definite thumbs up for me as well. Number three, third match. It was supposed to be the Social Outcast versus like Big Show and Kane, but it all just turned into one big brawl to advertise the Andre the Giant Memorial Battle Royal. And anybody who's been watching me knows that I want the Andre Battle Royal to matter. I think it could be something that could be cool for people's careers, but they're slapping the word Andre the Giant on it and basically calling it prestigious without there being any prestige to back that up. So that's a fucking huge thumbs down for me, and I don't give a damn about the Andre Battle Royal. Not gonna lie, if you're using the Social Outcast, Big Show, and Kane to build it up, I mean, that kind of speaks for itself. Let's move the fuck on. So Triple H and Stephanie have a promo. Basically, to sum it up, Sunday is all about the game. Triple H says that he is obsessed with winning. Reigns relit the fire under him because he had started to think that he was becoming the suit. He was okay with the fact that he wasn't a champion anymore and that he was taking a back seat, but that what Roman Reigns did to him back at TLC lit a fire under him and made him want that championship back, made him want to be on top again and be the most successful wrestler in history, etc. So the promo did go on for a lot longer than I think it needed to. I think we could have gotten a good 3-4 minutes out of them, but instead it felt like we got about 15. I think it was only about 8 or 10, but it just felt really long. Anyway, Roman Reigns ends up coming out and then brawling with Triple H a little bit. Triple H eventually flees the scene. Stephanie stays in the ring a little longer, and I'm like, please Superman punch and or spear her just to make yourself look like a badass. But of course, that unfortunately didn't happen, and then they flee the scene, and Roman Reigns is in the ring getting booed like crazy. So again, I think this is a huge missed mark opportunity. This is your main event. This is your world title match. And the guy who's supposed to be the hero who takes the championship from the greedy corporate boss in Triple H is Roman Reigns. And instead of him being cheered on and people wanting him to win, they're more excited about Triple H retaining the title. He literally punched Roman at one point and everyone went, yay. Reigns reversed, and everyone went boo. I mean, it's very clear and very obvious that people are not on the side of Roman Reigns. Now, I'm a Roman Reigns fan. I think that he definitely is what main event material needs to be, and I think that he has a lot of potential. Now, I don't think that he's necessarily the guy to go to, but I definitely think that he's a world champion type caliber wrestler. But here's the problem. When you have a WWE being as apparently not up to snuff on realizing that this is a guy who needs to be treated like a badass and treated like somebody who does not give a damn. And showing that he doesn't give a damn, he'd Superman punch Stephanie right in the face and not even think twice. That is a badass. Now, that's almost kind of a tweener character, but people are going to cheer for that because everyone hates Stephanie. So people are going to like that. People are going to get behind that. It's like the same thing when, like, you know, somebody would hit a finisher on, like, a Vicky Guerrero. Same type of thing. It's instant cheers because they hate the person. It just doesn't matter that it's man-on-woman violence. This is professional wrestling, not real life. So I really think that that could have added to this. But honestly, the whole thing was built up terribly. I remember saying after Fastlane that the biggest key to Triple H versus Roman Reigns at WrestleMania was the buildup. And the buildup has been honestly really poor. Reigns comes out of action after the first week, which honestly was probably the best buildup week of all. And then he's out for a couple weeks. And I understand that there's nothing they could do except, but they could have had him, you know, do a home video package. They could have done different things to at least make his presence be felt. Now he doesn't even come through the crowd like he used to. So he already kind of loses that singularity. He loses the uniqueness to the entrance that he had. He doesn't seem as badass. He just kind of walks and slumps down to the ring. And, like, I just don't feel the connection. I think they're trying to make him feel like a badass, or at least they did the week he came back. But it was just too little, too late. And the packaging and the way that they've done this has just been all wrong. So it's going to get a thumbs down from me because this is the main fucking event and it's just not good enough. So, and it didn't do anything to sell me on this match, and that's what the go-home show is supposed to do. Next match, the fourth of the evening, Kofi Kingston defeats Alberto Del Rio. The New Day cut a promo beforehand about booty-os. Pretty much the same shtick that you normally see from the New Day, and they were always fantastic, so I'm not undermining anything they had to say. You know, it was a great way to kick things off, but it is becoming kind of the same routine pretty much every week. They say what they have to say, you know, then they say they're the WWE World Tag Team Champs. I know I sped that up. And then, you know, they talk about Bootio cereal, and ultimately the League of Nations music plays, and fuck everyone's life. We all hate the League of Nations. And there we go. So at least Kofi beat Del Rio. And then afterwards, Jonathan Coachman makes an appearance. Apparently, SportsCenter is going to be doing coverage on the night of WrestleMania. And he loves New Day and brought out some Bootio cereal and danced to the theme song with New Day. That was freaking awesome. Honestly, that piece with Coachman was better than really the rest of it. So a huge thumbs up for Jonathan Coachman appearing on Raw. And a huge thumbs up for New Day continuing to be New Day. And continuing to beat League of Nations. And I guess because the tag titles aren't on the line at WrestleMania, it's safe to assume that the League of Nations would win the match, and it's just an excuse to have them win a match without actually putting the belts on them. Smart strategy if you're WWE, because putting the belts on them would be fucking stupid, because the League of Nations fucking suck. Anyway, next one, we have Roman Reigns backstage falling into a trap set by Triple H and the Dudley Boys. So basically, it's a 3-on-1 beatdown. My biggest question: where the hell were the Usos during this segment to come even the odds? A, they have a match against the Dudleys at WrestleMania, and B, they're going to let their cousin get the shit beaten out of them? I mean, it's not to say that they would have known about it. I guess you could say, like, oh, but they wouldn't have known, whatever. But, like, I mean, for crying out loud, why wouldn't they have been around? You know what I'm saying? There's no reason, at least in my opinion, why they couldn't have had the Usos run in and help to even the odds and to make things just make a little bit more sense. But again, I guess I shouldn't be concerning myself with things making too much sense. But either way, I guess the trap that was set, I mean, at least it led to there being more to this whole thing, but it really didn't do a whole lot for me, to be completely honest. So yeah, thumbs middle type of thing for that one. Next up is Kalisto defeating Connor of the Ascension. Ryback comes into the ring. They have a stare down. They're going at it for the U.S. title. Completely forgot because the last couple of Raws, they haven't even, they've literally done nothing to build up the U.S. title match. So here I am, rock you like a hurricane. Sorry, I didn't even mean to say here I am like that. So funny. Everyone's like, dude, this guy is so stupid. Anyway, yeah, the U.S. title buildup, fucking non-existent, horrible, and made me make a terrible joke. That's how stupid it is. It might as well just be called a terrible joke. I mean, I'm not saying that Kalisto versus Ryback is a bad match, because honestly, it has potential to be something fun and something decent. But instead of that, we just get a stare down and that's it. Like, I'm sorry, but that's not good enough for fucking WrestleMania. My standards are a little higher than that. Thumbs the fuck down. Moving on, Paul Heyman, Brock Lesnar, Dean Ambrose segment. So Paul Heyman, you know, cuts the usual promo on Brock Lesnar and Dean Ambrose's match, and basically says that Dean Ambrose may think that he's able to fool the Beast, you know, because of using weapons, and goes off on how weapons are that term shouldn't be banned and everything, and he's damn right about that. That's why you like Paul Heyman. He's not afraid to, you know, say things that aren't supposed to be said, or something that the people in the back are shaking their heads over. I think that's funny. Anyway, though, Ambrose comes out with a big wagon and just collects a bunch of weapons and ultimately just walks away. So again, he's trying to get under the skin of Lesnar. He sent a message, you know, he basically was sending a message like, I got all my weapons, I'm going to come at you with everything on Sunday, without saying a damn word. So I like the innovation here. Now, you could argue that this is a wasted appearance for Brock Lesnar. No, I mean, that's kind of a fair argument, because he literally just stood there, grabbed a kendo stick at one point, and really did nothing else. He didn't go after Ambrose, he didn't do anything like that. But honestly, sometimes leaving with something being left to be desired with Brock Lesnar is actually a good thing, because it makes you look forward to when he actually is in action and actually does go out there and do something that much more. Now, I don't necessarily like when he appears for pretty much no reason, because you could have just had Ambrose torture Paul Heyman tonight, now, but it probably would have been even more fun. But to be completely honest, him appearing and not doing much, his presence still does mean something. So, I mean, I can see why, like, his appearances, calling them wasted appearances, maybe a bit of an overstatement. However, I still don't think this was amazing build-up in any way, shape, or form. I'm going to give this a thumbs middle. It wasn't terrible, it wasn't bad enough to be a thumbs down, but it certainly wasn't good enough to be a big thumbs up and be something that was like, yes, this is great build and development to this feud. It sends a message for what the type of match is going to be on Sunday, but honestly, it wasn't something that I felt really added and maybe like, yes, can't wait. Because honestly, out of all the matches, Shane and Undertaker is number one, and my second most looking forward to, the match I'm looking forward to the most after that is going to be Dean versus Brock Lesnar, no question. So it was all right, but definitely kind of just was not good enough. So then we get the Divas, all this BS with all of them. It's basically a total Divas advertisement, let's be honest. Eva Marie was even brought into this whole thing. Emma was brought into it with her horrifying theme song that makes you do all these weird motions with your hands. And it's even worse now. And so there you go with that. And Brie Mode's involved. You know, like, you got all the terrible theme songs. And you got the people who deserve a push and aren't getting it, like Natalya, you know, etc. Eva Marie being involved, like, goddamn, she just got booed out of the fucking building. She might be absolutely gorgeous and stunning looking, but it doesn't take away from the fact that she's a terrible wrestler. And I think we all know that. Either way, I don't give a fuck. Thumbs the fuck down. And this apparently is all happening in the kickoff show. You can guarantee I will not be watching that. Moving forward, and it's hard to imagine that I'm saying that, because this is WrestleMania. R-Truth and Goldust have a little backstage segment where they basically, like, say they're not going to have each other's backs because they're both in the Andre Battle Royal. I mean, honestly, I don't even know why I bothered mentioning this, so thumbs down just for the sake of anything to do with that Battle Royal right now. Until they start to build a star out of it and make that victory matter, I'm not going to care about that match. Now we have the, oh my god, the six, I can't even handle this one. Six-man tag, Sami Zayn, Sin Cara, Dolph Ziggler defeat Kevin Owens, The Miz, and Stardust. Basically, everybody in the IC title ladder match, minus Zack Ryder because he wrestled earlier and won his match. The team of Zayn, Sin Cara, and Dolph get the win. Zayn pins Owens after Miz and Stardust left him. Why didn't they leave him earlier? Why didn't they just leave him from the beginning? It's a every man for himself at WrestleMania. Why are we teaming up 6 days before? Oh, is that lazy booking I hear calling? Oh, okay, that makes a little more sense. For crying out loud, this is about as lazy as it gets. Now, the crowd is chanting for Byron Saxton, CM Punk, RVD, let's go home, we don't want to be here. No, they didn't chant that one, but, I mean, they didn't. And they were bored out of their minds. I mean, they will let you know when something's good and when something's bad. Opening segment, they're chanting, holy shit, this is awesome. They're letting you know that Shane and Undertaker were doing something that they thought was fucking cool. And then you got this segment. They're literally telling you, this sucks. Why would you put a random six-man tag toward the end of the show and let it go on for like 20 minutes? That is so boring. I sat there absolutely bored during this entire thing. I was on social media. I'm doing other things. I wasn't even paying attention to a lot of the match because it was freaking boring. And everybody who thought it was boring, you're right. I mean, honestly, they could have gone with generic, have somebody grab a ladder, try to climb it, and everyone tries to fight and climb it, and then one person eventually does and holds up the belt. I would have rather had that generic segment than this generic segment, because this is laziness. This isn't build up, this isn't storytelling, this isn't like everyone getting a microphone and quickly saying why they're going to be IC champion. This is literally just a fucking thrown together six-man tag match that doesn't matter at all and doesn't do anything to build up the Intercontinental Championship going into WrestleMania. So a huge thumbs down for me. About 10 million of them. So then we end up finishing the night with Triple H and Roman Reigns, as we should. Roman Reigns and Triple H should be the final thing that we see on Raw on the go-home show, leading up to it. The whole roster ends up coming out to separate the two because they're brawling all over the place. And at the end of the day, Roman Reigns hits a big splash when everybody's trying to separate Triple H on the outside. And then Roman Reigns walks away with the momentum heading into WrestleMania. Pretty interesting stuff. I honestly thought that that was a little bit better. It made it feel like it was a bigger deal because the roster was involved. You know what I mean? If all those people were involved, it's like, oh man, it's a big deal because everyone's trying to separate them. It goes to show you that this is a match and a feud that everyone's watching, not just, you know, it's not just the two people in the title picture and everyone else doesn't exist and is outside of the bubble. Everybody does exist, and that bubble is everyone, so they all get involved. I thought that was definitely a good touch to finish the night. Still doesn't sell me on Reigns versus Triple H, but it certainly didn't leave me with a terrible feeling. This was not a good, great go-home show for WrestleMania. I mean, was this a decent go-home show for, you know, another pay-per-view, a regular old pay-per-view? I would probably argue yes, but I think that this lacked so much when it came to WrestleMania. I think the build-up has been really, really lacking, and the Shane and Undertaker thing tonight was really the only stuff that I could sit here and tell you that I feel like I'm more excited for that match as a result of what happened. A lot of mediocre stuff, a lot of not such great stuff. I will give a thumbs up to the final segment, by the way. But overall, this show is going to receive a C-. It honestly probably deserves a D because it just flat out wasn't great. But I will say there was some good stuff, like the Shane and Undertaker thing. The Dean and Brock thing wasn't too bad. You know, at least there was build up. That effort definitely needs to be accounted for as well. Coachman was on the show, even though that has nothing to do with the WrestleMania build-up itself. But yeah, overall, this was really just not a very memorable show in any way, shape, or form. They made things feel very personal between Vince and Shane and Shane and Undertaker. And everything else was like, yeah, I felt a little extra with Triple H and Roman Reigns. It was good, but it didn't really convince me of the match. Again, a lot of things done lazily or not with a whole lot of effort, I feel, on WWE's part. Now, I think this show, WrestleMania 32, could be quite a pay-per-view on Sunday, and I'm actually really looking forward to it. I'm not going to lie to you. Because it's WrestleMania, damn it. It's the biggest show of the year. Of course I'm going to look forward to it. But the build-up does a lot to tell you the temperature of the show, and more importantly than that, get you hyped up and get you in the right frame of mind. I shouldn't be watching a product every week where I'm like, man, I don't even want to watch WrestleMania. That shouldn't be your attitude, you know, and it kind of gets there. So anyway, thanks for watching, guys. That'll do it for the review. Please be sure to hit that like button, comment your thoughts on Raw, and of course, subscribe for plenty more to come. The next video is going to be with Jasmine. I know I didn't get a chance to do the top 10 video that I really wanted to, or any other Ultra reports, or any other uploads, but I'm just going to take a second to tell you guys, like, I have been dealing with a lot of stuff in life. A lot's been going on, and more importantly, school has just been extremely tough, and I've had a lot to do. You know, I had, like, three presentations this week, multiple tests this week, as well as working on top of that. So just a lot going on. It's not like I don't want to be uploading constantly. It's just I flat out don't have a whole lot of extra time and have been really stressed out as a result. So the next video will be with Jasmine live on Google Hangouts, probably around between 5 and 6 Eastern. Hopefully, her and I are going to discuss, you know, if that's a good time or not. If she isn't available to do it, I will still be recording and uploading my predictions that day. So anyway, I hope you guys will stick around for the WrestleMania predictions video, and then I will be doing the Q&A either this weekend, maybe a Saturday Q&A potentially, but might move it to early next week after WrestleMania. But either way, I will keep you posted. The next time you'll see me is for those predictions videos, and then from there, we'll go to the WrestleMania review Sunday evening, and I really can't wait for the pay-per-view, even if the card isn't as great as it could be, and the build-up has been dismal. I am still looking forward to WrestleMania 32. Anyway, look forward to seeing you guys for the predictions video, and I will see you then. Thank you, as always, for watching, and until then, peace out. Ultra out.